Hello, dear friends. Let's start our lecture. Today we will discuss auscultation of organs of healthy patient, and mostly we will focus on auscultation of lungs and heart. Let's go to discuss. First, we will discuss about auscultation of respiratory system, auscultation of lungs. And before the auscultation, I'd like to remind you normal structure of respiratory system. And you remember that normally we have upper airways and lower airways and parenchyma of lung parenchyma. Upper airways includes nasopharynx, larynx, and trachea. You remember the those structures represented by large tubes, and there are also lower airways which are represented represented by a generation of bronchi, and last one is lung parenchyma, which include those structures like alveoli and also interstitial tissues and vessels and etc. And you remember that some disorders may affect the bronchial tree, which may result in disorders like bronchial asthma or COPD or chronic bronchitis, acute bronchitis, yeah, and or bronchial ectasis. And also you remember disorders which can affect the alveoli and interstitial tissue. Those disorders we call as pneumonitis or pneumonia. Okay, but now we will focus on the auscultation of normal organism, healthy organism. And for auscultation, we use two types of auscultation, direct and indirect auscultation. Of course, direct auscultation was kept till inventing of stethoscope, you remember. Yeah, after inventing stethoscope, always we use indirect auscultation. There are basic rules of auscultation of lungs and rule of auscultation, rules of auscultation, mostly similar with the rules of percussion and palpation. The room where the auscultation is performed should be quiet and warm, and if possible, patient taken an upright position, naked to the waist, and stethoscope is pressed tightly against the chest. And at each point of auscultation, you should provide 2 to 3 respiratory cycles. For example, you are putting your stethoscope in one side and you ask patient, please breathe in and breathe out. And your patient should provide this two times. During auscultation, you can get two types of sounds, the physiological and adventitious or additional sounds and pathological sounds. There are two main physiological sounds, vesicular breathing and laryngotracheal breathing. And also in case of pathological processes, maybe be additional sounds like wheezing, crepitus, pleural friction noise, and etc., or pleural friction rub. Let's start from vesicular breathing. Vesicular breathing, you see, formatted, will be hearable on the whole surface of lungs. And vesicular breathing, this very soft, gentle blowing breathing, which formatted in alveoli, you see mechanisms of formation of vesicular breathing. This vibration of elastic wall of alveoli most intense during inspiration. When you put your stethoscope on the lung area, it will be hearable whole inspiratory phase and only 1/3 part of expiration. For example, you can represent this breathing when you are, for example, inflate the balloon. For example, you are inflating balloon, yeah? And if you connect, for example, a narrow tube with the end of this balloon, during deflating of this balloon, that formates the sound like squeaking, yeah, squeaking. And this is squeaking during deflating of this balloon. In one time will stopped, this balloon continue, this balloon continue to deflate without sound. This is same with the alveoli, alveoli enlarging and alveoli deflating, but no sound. The same during auscultation of vesicular breathing, it'll be hearable whole inspiratory phase, but expiratory phase only 1/3 part. Severity of loudness of vesicular respiratory breathing depends on airway patency status, depends on elasticity of lung tissue and ability of alveoli to quickly stretch and collapse. Depends also on intensity of ventilation of lungs and state of respiratory muscles, the ability to provide the power of airflow, and also depends on thickness of chest wall. For example, developing of fat and muscle layers. There are variants of vesicular breathing, maybe quantitative or qualitative changes, and quantitative changes may be enhancing or weakening of vesicular breathing. Qualitative changes is saccadic breathing, and also quantitative and qualitative changes may be represented by puerile breathing. Physiological weakening and enhancing of vesicular breathing. You see normal vesicular breathing, and ratio between the normal inhalation and exhalation 3:1. And it doesn't matter this is vesicular weakening or vesicular enhancing of vesicular breathing, those ratio 3:1 ratio, they're keeping, continuing to keep, but only in weakening we have shortening of inspiratory and shortening of expiratory phase. In enhancing, increasing of duration of inspiratory and increasing duration of expiratory, but ratio still keeping. Physiological weakening of vesicular breathing is observed when, for example, thickening of chest wall due to excessive development of muscle obesity. A patient, for example, athlete with a big muscle mass, or your patient is very obese. On those situations, of course, you can auscultate weakening of vesicular breathing. And sometimes in case of shallow breathing at rest or sleeping people at rest, especially in athletes. Physiological enhancing of vesicular breathing observed in patient who has thin chest wall, mainly in asthenics, a patient who has poorly developed muscle and subcutaneous fat layer, or sometimes maybe appear in hard physical work or in a psycho-emotional overstrain of patient. But you should remember, nota bene, always physiological weakening and physiological enhancing of vesicular breathing occur simultaneously in the right and left halves of chest. Always will be symmetrical area. For example, in one area you auscultate normal breathing, and another area, for example, in opposite part and lower part of lungs, you detect physiological or you detect weakening of vesicular breathing. Those will be not physiological. Those will be pathological. For example, maybe pneumonia, for example. Quantitative changes of vesicular breathing, like saccadic breathing, normal saccadic breathing, characterized by interrupting of inspiration, but expiratory phase is normal. You see interruption of inspiratory phase, expiration phase is normal. Mechanisms connected with non-simultaneously, you see, non-simultaneous entry of air into a different part of lung tissue, into different alveoli. This may be developed due to uneven contraction of respiratory muscles during, for example, shivering, nervous tremor, or shivering because of cold and etc. This because of shivering, because of, for example, increasing at the first stage of fever, or shivering because of nervous tremor may cause the uneven contraction of respiratory muscles and cause this saccadic breathing. Next is puerile breathing. Puerile breathing, a cue of character for puerile period. And here is, we have auscultation. During auscultation, you can get a whole inspiratory phase and whole expiratory phase. Next one, after fascicular breathing, normally you can auscultate laryngotracheal breathing. Laryngotracheal breathing formatted only in larynx and trachea in large tubes. This noise is coarse and high frequency timbre noise, and well, only hearable when you put your stethoscope on larynx or trachea, characterized by hearability of a whole inspiratory phase and slightly increased duration of expiratory phase. You see, whole inspiration and whole expiratory phase will be hearable in laryngotracheal breathing. One of type of laryngotracheal breathing, this is bronchial breathing, which formatted in large bronchi. Mostly bronchial breathing may be auscultated in area of large tubes like trachea and bifurcation of trachea. You remember that in interior region of patient, bifurcation of trachea occur on the level of unguis ludovici, or in the region of second intercostal space. On this region, in anterior region, will be hearable normal bronchial breathing, which characterized by hearability of whole inspiratory phase and whole expiratory phase. In opposite part, in posterior part, this is bifurcation of trachea occurs on the level of T3 and T4, also hearable whole inspiration and whole expiratory phase. Mm-hmm. This is normal bronchial breathing. When perform auscultation of lateral parts of chest, patient's arm should be raised behind the head. This is a rule. And when performing auscultation from behind posterior region, patient's head should be slightly lowered and arms should be crossed over the chest to get more opportunity to auscultate the region between the scapulas. During auscultation of lungs, breathing sounds are compared during inspiration and compared their nature, duration, loudness, and should be assessed in symmetrical points. So this is symmetrical comparative auscultation of lungs. You remember comparative percussion of lungs, and we are auscultated on the same points of percussion. You see always percussion and also auscultation. We start from anterior region, anterior upper part to down, and then we are going to the lateral part and posterior part. Auscultation of lungs started from supraclavicular fossas. Of course, always you should auscultate apexes of lungs, and then you are going by intercostal spaces, and you are auscultating symmetrical points with ignoring of heart area, you see. And then you are going to auscultate lateral part, and you see points where you put your stethoscope. Don't ignore especially zone of middle lobe of right lung. Yeah, you see middle lobe of right lung. Here is detected by, here is fourth rib, here is sixth rib, slope of fourth rib and slope oscilloscope of sixth rib. And please don't forget this zone also. And auscultation of lung in posterior region, of course, first, of course, you in supraclavicular or suprascapular region, and then between the scapels and under the scapular region. Okay, here is again, you see how we auscultate, and you should assess the main respiratory sounds, and main respiratory sounds assessed with calm breathing of the patient through his nose. If you are suspecting any additional sounds, any additional pathological sounds like crackles, like for example, pleural friction drop or like wheezing sound, you may use any techniques, special techniques, like ask patient to breathe deeply through his mouth, or ask him to make force inhalation or exhalation, or imitate inhalation. All these special techniques we will use to detect the clarify the, for example, rails, and to differentiate rails from crepitus and etc. Okay, we will discuss in our future and discuss together with symptoms or syndromes. How may change the vesicular breathing in pathology? Now we discussed about the already discussed about the physiological enhancing or weakening of vesicular breathing, but maybe vesicular breathing change in pathology. There also may be quantitative changes and qualitative changes. Quantitative also may be pathological enhancing of vesicular breathing and pathological weakening of vesicular breathing, and qualitative maybe heart breathing, and maybe vesicular breathing with prolonged expiration, and saccadic breathing, pathological saccadic breathing. Pathological weakening of vesicular breathing may be characterized, appear in such pathologies like hydrothorax, accumulation of fluid in pleural cavity, may decrease audibility of breathing, and will be decrease audibility of vesicular respiration, vesicular breathing. Hydrothorax or maybe pneumothorax, you see, and diffuse weakening of vesicular breathing, maybe because of increased airness of lung tissue during emphysema or during first stage of lobar pneumonia maybe. Nexus, extrapulmonary causes of weakening of vesicular breathing are connected with severe general asthenia of patient, for example, or a dysfunction of respiratory muscles during myasthenia gravis, myopathies, myositis, during pathologies of diaphragm muscles, diaphragmitis, or sometimes weakening of vesicular breathing pathological may be connected with pronounced obesity, you see, or widespread subcutaneous emphysema, or edema of subcutaneous tissue in cardiac and renal pathologies, or may connected with the ankylosis of costal vertebral joints pathology in spondyloarthritis, spondylitis, or any chest traumas, myositis, and rib fractures may also be a cause of decreasing or weakening of vesicular sound. Pathological enhancing of vesicular breathing, enhancing, increasing audibility of vesicular breathing, mechanisms connected with a vicarious or compensatory mechanism. You see here is pathological, enhancing of vesicular breathing, maybe in those region, in healthy region, for example, For example, imagine that this region, for example, affected by pneumonia, one lobe switch off by pneumonia, and this lobe not working. Other parts of lungs, healthy part of lungs, try to compensate and increase function, and this is compensatory increasing function, and healthy part will increase the vesicular breathing or enhance the vesicular breathing. Okay, and sometimes may appear pathological bronchial breathing. What is pathological bronchial breathing? You remember that physiological bronchial breathing appear only on the bronchus, yeah, main bronchus and bifurcation of trachea, you see, on this region. And you remember that on this region will be hearable whole inspiratory expiratory phase. But in case of, for example, massive pneumonia, for example, in case of pneumonia, lobar pneumonia, we have accumulation of exudate in all alveoli, and alveoli become to be very hot and develop the consolidation of lung tissue. And you remember that a hot consolidated tissue conducts the sound better, and on this region appear pathological bronchial breathing. That means it will be hearable whole inspiratory and whole expiratory phase. For example, massive consolidation, lobar pneumonia, second stage, yeah, and sometimes may be hearable in case of complete compression atelectasis. What is compression? This lung may compressed by very large fluid which accumulated in pleural cavity, and in compressed region also may be hearable pathological bronchial breathing. Next is another types of bronchial breathing. But bronchial breathing, this is amphoric breathing. Amphoric breathing formated in large cavities, which is more than 5 to 6 centimeters in size, and which communicated with the bronchi. Bronchi, this is large abscess, for example, formated, is communicated with large bronchi, and this abscess we can see a level of fluid, level of, for example, pus, and also level of air. On this region will be hearable amphoric breathing. Amphoric breathing you may represent or simulate if you blow into the neck of empty bottle, for example, yeah, and it's a representative of amphoric breathing. For example, today after lecture you may just blow into the empty bottle and represent amphoric breathing. Like this breathing you may auscultate on the big size abscesses. Another type is bronchial breathing, is metallic breathing, which may be caused by open pneumothorax, and on this may be occur in rare cases if this open pneumothorax communicated with a visceral pleura, and you see, you may auscultate on this region. Bronchial breathing also will be all inspiratory and expiratory phases, but with a metallic timbre. Next is stenotic breathing, is also a variant of bronchial breathing over the areas of narrowing of larynx and trachea. And in this case may occur because of swelling or edema or foreign body of the larynx and trachea, mostly occur in children, yeah, you remember. And another abnormal lung sounds like crackles, wheezing, raunches, and stridor and pleural friction rub. We will connect it with the inspiratory and expiratory phases. And also we will study in future together with our syndromes like bronchial obstructive syndrome, like consolidation of lung tissue syndrome, damaging of pleura syndrome. But now, now you should remember that normally it will be hearable inspiration, expiration, and only hearable on the lungs, on the vesicular breathing, but sometimes may appear dry wheezing in case of, for example, bronchial asthma or bronchial obstructive syndrome. A dry wheezing hearable whole inspiratory and expiratory phase. For example, wet rails maybe appear in bronchitis, yeah, damaging of bronchitis, non-obstructive damaging of bronchitis, yeah, it will be hearable whole inspiratory expiratory phase. Crepitus, this is a type of abnormal breathing sound which appear in first and last stage of pneumonia, for example, mechanisms of formation. This is expansion of alveoli damaging. This may be appear only on the top of inspiratory phase, and etc. We'll discuss adventitious breath sounds together with our pathological symptoms. For example, wet rails, maybe there are three types of wet rails, like large bubble, medium bubble, and fine bubble or small bubble, wet rails. Large bubble rails formed on the large cavities, for example, and medium bubble formed in bronchitis of medium generation of bronchitis, middle generation of bronchitis, and fine bubble formed in small bronchitis. You remember, crepitus formed in alveoli, stretching of the inflamed alveoli cause the formation of sound on the top of inspiratory phase. We will discuss together with consolidation of lung tissue syndrome. Pleural friction rub, formated friction because of changing of surface of visceral and parietal pleura, they become to be very rough and formated the sound. In dry pleuritis, formated the pleural friction rub, and often pleural friction rub accompanied by chest pain, local chest pain. Also, we will discuss together with damaging of pleura syndrome. Next is auscultation of heart. Auscultation of heart is very important because here we should by auscultation we can detect many pathological processes, including not changing of only sounds. Also, we can find out additional sounds like murmurs or clicks and additional tones. Heart auscultation, normally auscultated four valves, you remember, yeah. This is two AV valves and two semilunar valves. Two AV valves includes bicuspid valve, tricuspid valve, and two semilunar valves, they are aorta and pulmonary artery valve. Always you should remember that inflow veins like vena cava superior inferior and also inflow veins like pulmonary veins, they don't have valves, yeah, only don't have valves. It's very it's a diagnostically important and clinically important. Why? If they don't have valves, that means increasing pressure in right atrium, also as well as increasing pressure in left atrium, cause automatically increasing pressure in inflow regions of those veins. For example, increasing pressure in right atrium automatically can increase pressure in vena cava superior and inferior region and cause the in inferior region enlarging of liver, formation of ascites and leg edemas and enlarging of neck veins, for example. That's very comparative. Oh, complicated. Okay. Rules of auscultation of heart. You can auscultate heart in different position of patient, in standing, lying on the side, to detect the more clear sounds. And when holding your breath after exhalation, at rest, and after exercises, for example, after exercises may increase audibility of any murmurs and etc. There are four main valves and four main points of auscultation of those valves. For example, mitral valve. Normally, mitral valve auscultated on the region of apical impulse. From palpation lecture, you remember that apical impulse located on the fifth intercostal space, which crossed by midclavicular line to 1.5 centimeter inside from midclavicular line. And on this region will be audible mitral valve. Next is tricuspid valve, another AV valve, which is auscultated at xiphoid on the base of xiphoid process, on xiphoid process, but mostly in your books represented by the auscultation point of fourth intercostal space, left side of sternum. Next is aortic valve. Aortic valve auscultated on the second intercostal space, right side of sternum, and left side of sternum, second intercostal space, belongs to the auscultation of pulmonary artery valve. There are, you see, and also additional point or ERPS point. ERPS point, this is additional point for auscultation of aortic valve located on the third intercostal space, left side of sternum. Again, fifth intercostal space, 1.5 centimeters inside the midclavicular line, auscultated point of mitral valve, seconded tricuspid valve, fourth left intercostal space, aortic or xiphoid process or xiphoid process. Next is aortic valve, second right intercostal space, pulmonary valve, second left intercostal space, and ERPS point, third left intercostal space for aortic valve. But you should remember that auscultation point and projection of valves, that they have different area. For example, auscultation point for mitral valve is apex of lungs, but normally mitral valve located on the area of attachment of third rib to with the sternum. You see it on the third rib with the sternum attachment area, but auscultated on the apex. Why? Because through this valve, blood goes to the direction of apex, and on the apex more hearable and more clear hearable this valve. Next is xiphoid. On the xiphoid process, we auscultate tricuspid valve, but located between the, you see, on the right side, it will be fifth rib attachment. On the left side, it will be third rib attachment. On this diagonal, on the center of sternum, located tricuspid valve, but blood flow goes to the direction of xiphoid process, and on this area, it will be more hearable. What about aortic valve? Normally, aortic valve located in the middle of sternum. You see, on the middle of sternum, attachment area of third ribs, but clear auscultated on the second intercostal space, left side of sternum, because to this side, aortic arch of aorta closely to the second intercostal space. That's why we auscultate better and clear on the second intercostal space. Next is only one valve, pulmonary valve, projected area and auscultated area are same, and this is second intercostal space, left side of sternum. ERPS point, this is additional point for auscultation of aortic valve, which is located on third intercostal space, right, left side of sternum. Mostly ERPS point we use to detect the aortic regurgitation, for example, diastolic sound during valvular disease, aortic regurgitation. Okay. After getting of this points, or why we need auscultation point to detect the sounds and murmurs. First, of course, sound. Normally on the heart region, hearable only lap dab. You remember lap sound is one and dab sound is two sound. And you should able to distinguish these two sounds. Why is first is lap, another one is dab sound. Yeah. For this, you should assess properties of tones or sounds properties, rhythm, intensity, timbre, duration, and sometimes splitting. How formate the heart sounds? First sound and second sound, or lap and dab. Lap sound formated because of closing of mitral and tricuspid valves. You see a mitral simultaneously closing of mitral and tricuspid valve at the beginning of systolic phase, formatted as one sound. For example, if I am drawing this sound here, S1 sound, lap sound, formatted by closing, simultaneously closing of mitral and tricuspid valve. At the beginning of systole. At the beginning of systole, we have closing of these valves after overloading, loading of these ventricles, and then start systolic phase. From the beginning, systolic phase, after systole of ventricles, closed semilunar valves, aorta and pulmonary artery simultaneously closing aortic valve and pulmonary artery valve formate as two sound. This is sound is diastolic, beginning of diastole. And then again we have S1 sound, but you see S1 sound, but you see between the area, between the S1, S2 distance, between the S1, S2 sound, we call a systolic phase, and between the S2 and S1, again, diastolic phase. This is systolic phase, this is diastolic phase. But in diastole, another two sounds. After closing of aorta and pulmonary artery, we have opening, you see, opening of tricuspid and bicuspid valves, and during force filling of ventricles at the beginning of diastole, force filling of ventricles formated S3 sound, force filling, our passive filling of ventricles during diastole cause formation of S3 sound. You should always remember only closing of valves formated the sounds, opening always silent. That's why opening is not hearable, and ejection or force filling of ventricles cause the formation of S3 sound. As after filling of ventricles, our left and right atriums become to contract and squeeze out extra blood to the last blood to the ventricles and formate the S4 sound. And you see, in systole phase, we have only one sound, S1. In diastole phase, we have three sound. S2 sound, closing of aorta and pulmonary artery. S3 sound, force filling of ventricles. And S4 sound, contraction of atrium, sorry. And S1 sound, you should know that formated by closing of mitral and tricuspid valve. And this is sound is high frequency sound. Of course, if formated on tricuspid and mitral valve, it's more hearable, better hearable on the apex and xiphoid process. They are separated only about 0.01 second. That's why they are here audible by one sound, lap sound. S2 sound, formatted by closing of aortic and pulmonic artery valves, and always this hearable as one single sound, but normally separated, and maybe you can hear physiological splitting during deep inspiration, on the top of deep inspiration, the S1 and S2 sound will be hearable like splitting sound. Why? Because on the top of deep inspiration will be increased inflow to the right side, and we have delayed in closing of the pulmonic artery valve, and this sound will be hearable as splitting sound. You see deep of inspiration, you see pulmonic valve closing slightly delayed, and it'll hearable as splitting sound. We call this physiological splitting, but sometimes maybe pathological splitting we will discuss further. S3 sound, because of rapid filling of ventricles, third sound normally may be finding in children or young adults, because their ventricles are very elastic, and young elastic ventricle may cause formation of S3 sound physiologically. S3 sound also may be hearable in pregnant women. But if you are auscultated, if you found S3 sound in old person, 40 plus person, always you should suspect there any pathological processes. When appear pathological S3 sound, when our heart muscle become to be very weak, for example, in case of cardiomyopathies and myocarditis, congestive heart failure, all the situation may cause formation of, again, S3 sound. But S4 sound, which normally formated by contraction of atriums, normally never detectable, only pathological S4 sound. Mm-hmm. Okay. Audibility of S1 sound depends on AV valves, condition of AV valves, condition of mitral valve and tricuspid valve. And also, for example, if you see regurgitation, if you see insufficiency, if your patient has insufficiency of mitral valve or tricuspid valve, and you have diminishing of audibility of S1 sound. Depends, S1 sound audibility depends on speed of ventricular contraction, force detects dependable on speed of contraction. There, for example, we have a small ejection, the smaller ejection, the speed, the more, the quickly speed of contraction, and increased speed cause increasing of S1 sound. If we have overfilling of ventricle and speed of contraction decrease, decrease volume of S1, audibility of S1 sound. S2 sound depends, of course, on condition of pulmonary valve and aortic valve. For example, any insufficiencies of aortic pulmonary valve cause diminishing of S2 sound, and also depends on the speed of closing of semilunar valves and levels of blood pressure in those arteries. For example, increasing pressure in pulmonary artery cause increasing audibility of S2 sound. Increasing pressure in aorta cause also on the aorta increasing audibility intensity of S2 sound. How may change the heart sound? Of course, this may be intensification or weakening of sound. You see loud or soft, yeah? Increasing or decreasing audibility of this sound. A timbre may be flapping or metallic timbre, and may be splitting or formation of additional sounds. S1 weakening of S1 sound may have extracardiac and cardiac reasons. Cardiac causes, extracardiac S1 weakening of sound mostly connected with the excessive development of subcutaneous fat or chest muscles, for example, your patient is very obese, it's you may hear not clear S1 sound, diminishing S1 sound, or in emphysema of lungs, any processes which takes heart away from the anterior chest wall decrease audibility of S1 sound. But decreasing audibility of S1 sound may be connected with intracardiac causes also. For example, weakening of S1, S2 labdap sounds may because of decreasing contractility of heart muscles, for example, in myocarditis or in any cases of heart muscle damaging. Weakening of S1 sound on the apex, on the mitral valve, may be connected with, for example, mitral valve insufficiency, or in case of volume overload of left ventricle. Weakening of S1 sound on the xiphoid process, tricuspid valve, may be connected with the tricuspid valve failure or in overload pressure overload of right ventricle. Intensification of S1 sound characterized maybe appear in, for example, in all cases which takes heart closer to the anterior chest wall. Tumor of the posterior mediastinum takes heart closer to the anterior chest wall, or may connect it with the intracardiac causes, like intensification of both sounds may occur when activated sympathetic nervous system. For example, in case of heart physical work or grave disease, when increased intensity of metabolic rate. And intensification of S1 sound on the apex connected with, with the mitral valve. For example, mitral stenosis. Yeah, for example, increased S1 sound. Or for example, ejection of left ventricle is a small ejection of ventricles cause quickly force contraction. Speed of contraction increase and cause intensification of S1 sound. And intensification of S1 in xiphoid process, for example, connected with stenosis of tricuspid valve. Weakening and enhancing of S2 sound, intensification of S2 sound connected with the condition of course, aorta and pulmonary valve. For example, weakening of S2 sound over the aorta connected with insufficiency of aortic valve. Or weakening of S2 above pulmonary artery connected with the insufficiency of pulmonary valve, intensification or accent of S2 sound above the aorta connected with increasing pressure in aorta and increasing pressure in pulmonary artery cause intensification of S2 sound on the pulmonary artery. Sometimes maybe splitting. This is splitting when maybe physiological or pathological. Physiological, we already discussed about this, acute during deep inhalation, on the top of inhalation, physiological splitting, yeah, may be hearable only during inspiration. But pathological splitting keeps in inspiratory as well as expiratory phase. And splitting of S2 sound maybe depends on phase of pathological splitting, maybe because of increasing pressure in one of arteries, yeah, and when one closing of one valve lagging behind, yeah. For example, sometimes maybe in even blockages, yeah, aortic stenosis or left ventricular blockages and cardiac heart failure and etc. Left bundle branch blockages. And heart murmurs, this is also additional sounds we should be able to detect. This is murmurs or sounds, and according to origination, according to phase of cardiac circle, we detect two types of murmurs: systolic murmurs, which occur between the first and second sound labdapia, and diastolic, which formated between the S2 and S1 sound. This is diastolic murmurs. By the presence of changes in structures of heart, we detect two types of murmurs: organic murmurs and functional murmurs. Organic murmurs always connected with any structural defects like valvular heart disorder, stenosis or insufficiency, or structural defects of muscles, for example, dilation of cardiac cavities cause expansion of valve ring, and of course expansion of valves, AV valves, and cause the formation of sounds like heart murmurs. And functional, dependable on speed of blood, also dependable on viscosity of blood. For example, in anemia condition, decrease blood viscosity and maybe appear sound on the apex of heart like a systolic murmur. But also you should remember functional murmurs hearable only in systolic phase, never functional diastolic murmurs. Diastolic murmurs may be only pathological. Okay, you see, according to phases, maybe murmurs systolic and diastolic, and also crescendo decrescendo murmur, for example, in systolic aortic stenosis, holosystolic murmur, or maybe decrescendo, and decrescendo crescendo murmur. It dependable on also shape of murmurs. We will discuss together with these valvular heart diseases. Okay, I finished my lecture, my dears. Please.